So, hello everybody. My name is Alba Mello. I am a professor at the University of Brasília, Brazil, and I'm here to talk about parallel biological sequence comparison in large GPU clusters. So here we are talking about biological sequences. Once we obtain a biological sequence, we need to establish its properties and characteristics. And this is done by comparing the new sequences with the sequences for which we have already the characteristics and the properties. And so the comparison of biological sequences is one of the most basic and important operations in bioinformatics. The goal here is to define how similar the sequences are. There are in the literature exact algorithms that compare two sequences and produce the optimal result. These algorithms, they have quadratic time and memory complexity, which depend on the multiplications on the sizes of the sequences. There are also heuristic methods, which are faster, but they do not guarantee the optimal result. Here in this talk, we are talking about optimal results, exact algorithms. So Smith-Waterman proposed an exact algorithm based on dynamic programming to locally align two sequences in quadratic time and memory. Since it is an exact algorithm, it produces the optimal result. However, if you have long sequences, we can have high execution times and huge memory requirements. For instance, if we want to compare the human chromosome 1 with the chimpanzee chromosome 1, here we are talking about 249 million characters compared to 228 million characters. If we use the Smith-Waterman algorithm, we will need at least 240 petabytes of memory. In 2008, this particular comparison was considered unfeasible. And in this talk, I will show that this is feasible. The goal of the talk is to present and discuss our MASA-CUDA-ALIGN tool to compare huge chromosomes in GPUs. I will show you that we use a highly optimized algorithm to exploit the parallelism. We also use a speculative technique to accelerate the sequential part of the algorithm. And I will show results for up to 384 NVIDIA GPUs, which we use to compare the human and chimpanzee homologous chromosomes 1. I will also show some preliminary results of the next version of our tool in the IBM platform. So we are dealing with biological sequence comparison. If we want to compare two sequences, we must place one sequence above the other and compute a score. Here you have two sequences, S0 and S1. S1 has 11 characters, which are called base pairs. And here you can see an alignment. If the characters are the same, the value assigned for, this is a match, and the value assigned for it is +1. If the characters are not the same, this is a mismatch, and the value assigned is, in this example, is -1. We can also introduce gaps in one of the sequences. There is a penalty for doing that. In this case, it's -2. So the score is obtained by adding all these values. And so this alignment, for this alignment, the score is 6. But what we want, of course, is the alignment that has the highest score. And this is done by the Smith-Waterman algorithm. As I told you, it's based on dynamic programming with quadratic time and memory complexity. This algorithm executes in two steps. The first step, compute the dynamic programming matrix and obtain the similarity score. Second step, do the traceback and obtain the alignment. In order to compare, to compute the dynamic programming matrix, we use this recurrence relation that you're seeing here. It's very, we have four terms, including the zero. The two, the first and second terms consider gaps in one of the sequences. The third term, we compare the characters. If this is a match, we use the match value. Otherwise, we use the mismatch. This is an example of the Smith-Waterman algorithm. We place one sequence on the horizontal and the other sequence on the vertical. We fill the first row and column with zeros, and then we use the recurrence relation that I just showed you to compute the other cells. And then we compute everything. At the end of this step, we have the highest score that you're seeing here is 4, and the position where it occurs. Then we start the traceback. The traceback starts from here, and then we'll build the alignment from the end to the beginning until we find a cell which has 0 as a value. So this is very simple. But consider that we have 248 million characters here and 222 million characters here. So this is our problem. There are some Smith-Waterman variants. The first one is Gotaw. It computes the affine gap model. And in this case, if we have a sequence of gaps, the first gap has a higher value than the other ones. This algorithm computes three dynamic programming matrices instead of one, and it provides a better biological result. Time and memory complexity are quadratic. Hirschberg, in 77, proposed an algorithm that computes the Smith-Waterman in linear memory, and it used a divide-and-conquer recursive approach to obtain all the points that belong to the optimal alignment. Time complexity is quadratic, but memory complexity is linear. So this is very interesting. And finally, Myers and Miller combined Gotaw and Hirschberg. So it computes the affine gap model in linear memory. So we will use these two algorithms of Gotaw and Myers and Miller. So how we do that in parallel? We need to evaluate the data dependencies. So each position in the matrix ij depends on I minus 1j, I minus 1, j minus 1, and ij minus 1. So we cannot compute everything in parallel. At the beginning, only the cell in blue can be computed. Then the cells in red, then the cells in yellow, and so on. The maximum parallelism is on the main antidiagonal of the matrix. And then the parallelism decreases again. So this evolves as waves over the antidiagonals. And that's why it's called the wavefront method. So the parallelism is non-uniform, very small at the beginning, it increases, and then it decreases again. I will show you our tool. So our tool is MazakitaLine. The goal is to compare huge DNA sequences in GPU with, and we combined Gotaw and Myers and Miller. So we have many versions of this tool. The first one, we computed the similarity score, which means step one of the algorithm in one GPU. CUDA-Line 2.0, the score and the alignment in one GPU, so the two steps of the algorithm. And CUDA-Line 2.1, score and alignment in one GPU with a pruning strategy. Then we went to multiple GPUs. CUDA-Line 3.0, only step one of the algorithm. We computed the similarity score with multiple GPUs. And finally, MazakitaLine 4.0, we computed the score and the alignment with multiple GPUs. This is mainly the thesis of a former PhD student of mine. This thesis was awarded the best PhD thesis in computer science in Brazil in 2016. And a paper from this thesis was received the Wilkes Award in 2019, which is given for the best paper published in the Computer Journal in 2018. So Let me show you how we do that in one GPU. Mazaki Online has 5 stages. Stage 1 will compute step 1 of the algorithm, compute the dynamic programming matrix. And stage 2 to 5 will compute step 2 of the algorithm, which is the traceback. So for stage 1, we will compute the whole matrix, but we will only store some rows. And at the end, we will have some rows and the point where the maximum value occurs. Then we will start stage 2, the traceback. From this point, of course, we read the row that's closer to it. We recompute. We find the point that belongs to the optimal alignment, which is a cross point. Having this point, we read the row that's closer to it and so on until we find the beginning of the alignment. Then we will go in the original direction, finding more cross points. Then we will go to CPU, finding more cross points. And in stage 5, we will find all the points that belong to the optimal alignment. So this is the most computing intensive stage for one GPU. How do we do that in GPU? We divide the dynamic programming matrix in blocks, and a set of blocks will compose an external diagonal. Each CUDA kernel will be invoked to compute one external diagonal. So for instance, here we have external diagonal D4. We have 3 blocks and multiple threads will compute here. But recall that the wavefront method, if we use the rectangle, we will have very low parallelism and then parallelism increase and then decrease again. So we will lose parallelism if we use rectangle. So we won't use rectangles. The first optimization that we proposed is to use parallelograms. So the first kernel invocation will stop at the last moment where we have maximum parallelism. And the second kernel invocation will start with maximum parallelism and so on. So most of the time we will have maximum parallelism only here, and here we don't have it. So it's very efficient. We also notice it because we have huge matrices that some parts of the matrices have a score that's so small that cannot lead to a score that is better than the score that we have already. So we can prune this part. For instance, here we have, imagine that the value of the score is 100 here. And up to the end of the matrix, I have 50 rows. And the best case is the match of all characters. And the value assigned for match is 1. So up to here, the maximum that I can have is 150. But the best score that I have so far is 230. So I can prune this area. And we do this reasoning by blocks, by not by cell. That's why it's called block pruning. So these are the publications for Mazaki Online in one GPU. The first one was in PPOP 2010. In this paper, we obtained the optimal score of chromosomes 21 human and chimpanzee. Here we are talking about 32 million of base pairs compared to 47 million of base pairs. This comparison took 21 hours, and the metric that we use to compare Smith-Waterman implementations is gigacups. Here is the billions of cells updated per second in the matrix. In this case, we had 20.3. Okay, then in CUDA line 2.0, we published in IPDPS 2011. Now, here we have all the stages, times for all the stages. You can see that stage 1 takes much longer than the others. And the same comparison of chromosomes 21, it was another GPU, of course, it took 18.5 hours, and the GigaCups was 23.6. Finally, for the pruning, block pruning, it was published on IEEE Transactions on Parallel Distributed Systems, 2013. This is a journal. Here, I'm showing you some optimal alignments. Here, the area in gray, we did not compute, but we obtained the optimal alignment anyway. With this approach, the same comparison of the chromosomes 21 took 8 hours, okay? And the GigaCups was better. But 8 hours is a lot of time. So we needed to go to multiple GPUs. And that's what I'm going to show to you. How do we do in multiple GPUs? We will do a multi-GPU wavefront. So each GPU will compute a subset of columns. And of course, the wavefront must be respected. So at the beginning, only GPU 1 will compute. When it arrives here, it sends it to GPU 2 that can start and so on. So we have a wavefront with the multiple GPUs. We also have an overlap between computation and communication with I/O buffers and I/O threads. The main challenge for multiple GPUs was the traceback. Here, we needed to parallelize a stage that is sequential. Let me show you. At the end of stage one, we have this point and some rows. So we have this point, we read this row, recompute until we find this point. Having this point, we read this row and recompute and so on. We cannot do this and this in parallel. Why? Because I don't know this point. This point can be here. And in this case, I will compute here. So this is sequential. The other stages we can do in parallel. It's no problem. But how do we do that? We use speculation. So in this case, each GPU will speculate that its local maximum belongs to the global maximum. So here you have 4 GPUs. The last GPU has the correct value. And it will start to do the traceback, to retrieve the cross points. The other GPUs have some local maximum, and they will speculate that it belongs to the optimal alignment. So this GPU will speculate and compute the alignment here. So the GPU 2 and 1. When GPU 4, which has the correct value, arrives here in the border, imagine that this is really the point. So we did not need to compute. Very good. But if it's not the point, we need to recompute. Recall that all the GPUs are speculating. So GPU 3, in this speculation, it has this point, which is different from this one. So GPU 2 will do another speculation. So each GPU can have many speculations to increase the probability of success. And this is why it's called incremental speculative traceback. This is the design of our approach without speculation from the point of view of GPUI. GPUI will be idle for TA, waiting for the wavefront to arrive in it. Then it will compute 41, and then it will be idle. When stage one finishes, the last GPU will retrieve the alignment and then send it to GPU n minus one and so on. And only when it arrives here, GPUI will compute. So it will stay TB time idle. Okay, and this is the time. With speculation, for stage one, it's the same thing. But as long as GPUI finishes to compute the subset of columns that it has, it starts speculation. All the GPUs do that. At the end of this stage, at this point, the speculation was not good. So we needed to recompute. But at this point, see, we don't spend almost no time here. So the speculation was good and so on. So we claim that we are able to reduce a lot of time doing speculation. And we did that. The publications for QDALINE 3.0, the first one was in PPOP 2014. We had an heterogeneous platform with three GPUs, and the comparison of chromosome 21 took 6 hours and 28 minutes. And here we have a much better gigacups. In CC Grid 2014, we used 16 GPUs to compare chromosome 21. It took 1 hour and 20 minutes. Recall that we started from 21 hours, so it's much better. The GCUPS is much, much better also. And here we used 64 GPUs to obtain the optimal score of the chromosome one, not the alignment, but the score in about nine hours. And the gigacups was 1.7 teracups. Finally, the publication for QDALINE 4.0 was in IEEE Transactions on Parallel Distributed Systems, 2016. We obtained all the optimal alignments between the human and chimpanzee homologous chromosomes. And using 384 GPUs, the comparison of the chromosome 21 took a few minutes, was very quick. And the best result that we have in gigacups was the chromosome 5. Here we are talking about 180 million of characters compared to 183 million of characters. This comparison took 53 minutes and we had 10.3 teracups. And this was our goal, of course, the optimal alignment of the chromosome 1, human and chimpanzee. We used 384 NVIDIA M2090 GPUs, and this comparison took 2 hours. In this comparison, we computed 56.91 petacells, so it was really huge. Okay, now what we are doing? We are trying to use, because in the multiple GPUs, we did not use block pruning because we had a problem of load balancing. So here we are trying to use block pruning for multiple GPUs. Without breakpoint, we will divide between four GPUs like that. With the breakpoint, we will process only half of the matrix. And then here we will evaluate the pruning pattern and then redistribute the columns. That's the idea. So the best result in the literature for Smith-Waterman in GPUs is QDALINE 4.0, 10.3 teracups, with 384 NVIDIA GPUs. We run in the IBM platform that has 8 NVIDIA Volta and the Power 9. And for 8 GPUs, we had 2.7 teracups. So we were very happy. We estimate that we are able to beat our best result with 40 NVIDIA Volta. Recall that we had this result with 384 GPUs. So we are very happy with our algorithm and with the NVIDIA Volta, of course. So I hope I was able to show you that biological sequence comparison algorithms that use dynamic programming can require an extraordinary amount of computing power. We claim that traditional solutions are unable to produce results in reasonable time for this huge comparison. High-performance solutions that use GPU, I showed you, they can provide impressive performance results for these applications. But we need to work on the algorithm. As I showed you, we have the parallelogram, we have pruning, we have speculation. And also we need to program very well in GPU, of course. Advanced GPU programming is needed. This work was not done just by me. First, I want to thank my former PhD students Adam Sandes, and my current PhD student, Marco Figueiredo, and also my undergrad student, Bernardo, that worked in this part that I just showed you. My colleagues from Brazil, that worked in Kida Line, colleagues from Barcelona Supercomputing Center in Spain, and also colleagues from Canada, France, and so on. I want to thank also the Barcelona Supercomputing Center for providing access to the Minotaur GPU cluster. We run Kida Line 3.0 there. The XSEED platform in the USA for providing access to the KFS. In this case, we used the 384 GPUs, and now we are using bridges with the Voltas. I want to thank NVIDIA Brazil for providing access to Pascal and Volta. And finally, IBM USA and the University of Oregon for providing access to the Power9 and Volta platforms. Our code is available at GitHub. Let me show you, many institutions in many countries around the world have been using our code. So in Brazil, of course, Croatia, France, India, Japan, Singapore, Spain, and the USA. And very important, we are open to collaborations. Thank you very much. That was my talk. Thank you. Let me see the question and answers. There are something. Okay. Thank you. Is somebody there? I don't know if I will close the session. Thank you for attending. Okay. Thank you, Zaid. Thank you very much. We are open to collaborations, okay? If you want to talk after the, if you are interested in this topic and you want to talk about it, we are very open to collaborations. Thank you. Sorry. Okay, I will keep the conversation. So this was interesting for us, but the chromosome 1 that was our goal is not the longest chromosome in nature. In fact, we have a chromosome that has 700 million characters, and it is a small flower, white flower. So our goal now is to compare this flower, Japanese flower, which is really, really big. So what I think is that bioinformatics tools, they are very interesting. Bioinformatics algorithms, they are very adequate for HPC. So we are very happy. I only showed you a pairwise comparison, but we do multiple sequence comparison. We do structural alignment of RNA structures, which needs, of course, biological sequence comparison, HPC also. So this is, if you like HPC and you if you like biology, this is a very nice part of, very nice field for you to be. So thank you for attending. I think I will close the session. If there are no more questions, let me see. Ah, sorry. Oh, yes. Sorry, Zaid. So now I saw. Burroughs Wheeler is for the DNA BWE, is Burroughs Wheeler. Is for DNA assembly. No, we don't. We do not work with Burroughs Wheeler because a lot of people were working, very good people, were working on it, and we did not. And now there is the PacBio, another kind of sequencer, where we have longer reads. So in this case, we needed to adjust the algorithm. It's not common sense that we will use Burroughs-Wheeler for this PacBio sequencer. But yes, yeah. But very good people here in the US. So I know that Srinivas Aluru in Georgia Tech, has been working with that. Bertil Schmidt in Germany, also they are very good in this area. And so since there are a lot of good people, we are working in sequence comparison. That's it. Yeah. Okay.